Okay, let's get started, I guess. Starting off with actually getting the right window up. There we go. And now going to make a quick change to the script. Now, I'm hoping I can get these to build into the SRC folder, not just a random build folder, so yeah, got my GitHub repository here. Ascii Lemmings, there we go. Let's go to Assemblyscript and see what options I have for development. Actually, let's just see if it tells me. Ah, yes, it does. So, let's have a look. The builds. Specifies the output file. I don't want just one file, though. Wonder if I can just use this and it will generate the other stuff. So I think it's the WASM that we're interested in, so can I just do it like that, I wonder? Let's give it a try. Let's get so optimize.wasm and untouched.wasm. Okay, that goes, and well, it moved it, I think. Nope, it's still in the same place. Okay, so let's actually specify. sure that did nothing. Let's have a look at some more of these options then. Unless... entry file then options. So I should be able to specify out file after target, right? Binary text.js, source map debug, memory table runtime. Nothing useful there, so let's dig into Google. I wonder if I need to specify base directory as well. It says it defaults to dot. Really annoying that I can't specify a different input base directory and output base directory. So let's try moving target after it. Just in case that is something that matters. Nope, not at all. Binary text. Some what? And what's the other one we have? Oh, map. That just happens anyway. Let's see if we can get a example here. PS config controlling something. Next common module logic. No, so let's have a look at this. That one can go, that one can go. In fact, everything else can go. Oh, right, we want to change these as well. Because I'm using yarn and not npm. Let's try binary file rather than out file. Hey, there we go. So I needed binary file. It's not doing the WAT, but I don't think I can actually read that thing. It's just not something my brain is set up to do yet. So, okay, good. That's in SRC, so now if we run that, and in our index, not server index, normal index, yeah, it's here. That's index.js, yep. When we fetch that, we actually want to do we'll do untouched for now, just because it may be possible that no, actually let's do optimized, because both are binary so I can't read them. So let's localhost 8080. Can't get five icon. Oh, here. There we go. It's working. Yes. Right. So what I'm going to do is add HTTP server as a dev dependency, because it's always good to have these things ready to go straight out of the box. We can remove Express. We don't need anything in Sava anymore. Just very quickly. No, I won't bother with a fav icon just yet. Okay. So. That's running perfectly. Oh yeah, that's what I was going to do. I was going to add in a script for let's do that. Hopefully, it works. Yes, 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 yes. Excellent. So it can't find the source map. Doesn't look like he's even trying to load it. Well, that's a problem for another day. So let's just get this committed quickly. Excellent. So, what's next? Well, that's why I've got these issues. Okay, so I've done that one. But I'm not signed in, so I can't check it off. That's fine, I'll do it later. Yeah, I woke up yesterday morning. I started the stream off on Thursday night, and we basically got this file up and running, which, in fact, we don't need add because we're not doing anything with it. So, we've got the level, which is laid out in text. Each line, each entry in the array is basically a row on screen, and each character in the string is a column on screen. And all it's doing at the moment is when we call the test function from JavaScript, it will tell JavaScript to clear what it's got. And then it will run through each line of the array and display the text string. And in JavaScript, we've just got we fetch the WebAssembly file, we instantiate it with imported object, which basically says these are JavaScript functions that you can call. So clear just empties out the div that we've got, and display will use the assembly script helper method getString, because everything that comes into JavaScript from assembly script is a pointer to a memory location, and so it just displays each one with a line break. And once we've instantiated it, we don't need exports anymore. Don't need that. Oh yeah, and we don't need these two. They were all tests. So we've got our test function, which we pull from the assembly script exports, and then we run it, and it does one run through, which displays it on the screen. And anytime we want to build, we run yarn as build, which was set up by the helper. I believe it is assembly script in the dev dependencies, which is the helper. This loader, I don't think we're using that as a dependency because we want it in JavaScript, not in Node. So in our HTML file, we just pull it in from their CDN. And that's about it. It took about an hour and a half to get that far. But happy with that. And now we just have to continue on. So, next up, let's ignore that one for now. Create a lemming object. So, now, I'm going to go ahead and assume that any valid TypeScript is valid assembly script until it throws an error. And if it throws an error, then we can go back and get rid of it. So I'm going to chop everything into this file for now, but hopefully I can move some stuff out fairly quickly. So we want a lemming action, so fooling because they start off through the trapdoor and that's the fast thing to do, walking because usually they hit the ground and they start walking. Sometimes you do things in between, like you give them an umbrella. Did walk. Those aren't in order of what they appear on the bar. In fact, let's look that up. Oh, come on. Images. Right. So we have the UI here. And ignoring time up, time down, we've got climb, float, then explode. Explode is very close to the front, considering you don't usually need it unless you want to get rid of a blocker or you've run out of bashes. So after explode, then it's blocker. Brick or build, call it build, then bash, then mine, then dig. Then we've got pause the game and explode all lemmings, which unless you really mess up, well, it's a quick way of getting rid of any existing blockers on the level, or just fast restarting. But mainly I just use it when I think a lemming, like the last few lemmings to go through the exit are like less than 5 seconds away. I sometimes detonate all of the lemmings and hope they make it in time. So we've got lemming action there, and in fact I might as well save this because I'm sure I'll be referring back to it at some point. Let's just put it in my, yeah, keep it in my downloads for now. So, let's do a lemming interface. Get the directions in here. So they could actually be moving in any of these directions. If it's a standard level, they'll walk left, hit something, and walk other way around. They'll walk to the right until they hit something they can't walk past, and then they'll move left. If they are digging, they are moving down. If they're falling, they're moving down. If they are mining, they're moving down and left or down and right, depending on which direction they were before they started the action. If they are climbing or if they are building, then they can be moving either straight up or up left and up right. Then removed was the next option I was going to have. That's basically just, has this lemming got to the exit or have they been exploded? Either way, it's a lemming which has been spawned but shouldn't be rendered. Yeah. I guess I need a action time left. So let's look at types. unsigned integer 8. So now this is interesting. The unsigned 8-bit integer just gets stored straight into a 32-bit integer. I'm guessing at some point in the future they're planning on, or WebAssembly might be planning on introducing smaller types, which is why these are there. But if I've got it, I might as well use it, and considering each level is sort of, I guess, like 300 seconds, we don't even need 8 bits, really. 8 bits, 1 byte will get me 256? Oh, maybe we do. My binary math is a little bit rusty. Yeah, 255 plus 0. And in int 8, it's 127. So, I guess we go uint 16 just so that we could get, like, well, I don't know. Like 65,000 seconds or about 1,000 minutes. That'll do. Okay, yeah, so this would be used, it's not used so much for climbing or walking or fooling, which basically happens until they reach an obstacle, or floating. It is used for exploding because they get a 5-second timer that counts down. Not used for blocking. It's used for building because they get a certain number of bricks. It's used for, I think, mining. I think they mine a certain time. Mine, dig, bash might all be time limited. Yeah, I seem to remember that. So we've got movement, got removed. And action. I also wanted exit as an action. Or exited, I should say. For just so I can tell which lemmings are still in the level and which have gone. I know removed does that, but exited specifically would tell me how many were successful in getting out of the level, so that I can calculate the wind condition. And I don't believe there is anything else that they can do in the game. Okay, so, lemming object created. We're not doing anything with it yet, but we will do later. So we've got entrance and end and game timing. Let's do the game timing because it'll be easier to get everything else done. Right, so I think at this point it would be good to start splitting things off. So that in there and export them both. Is it set up for 4? Yeah. Let's fix that up quickly. Not 21. Right, so this one space is 2. That's better. And this one already had spaces too. Good. So, the game loop. I'll explain what I've written here, but basically the way I plan on creating lemmings is by looking at two different event loops. One of them is the standard one loop a tick, do everything as fast as possible loop, which most games have. I'm going to use it to, if the mouse moves over if the mouse moves over the game area, I want to track all of the movement within that game area and send it into Assemblyscript to process it, so all of those movements will be processed there. And also context updates, such as if the game decides that the mouse has moved over to one of the buttons at the bottom, for example, it needs to go to a hand pointer, and if it moves over a lemming, then we need to kind of put a bracket around the lemming, although I might do that in the game code and render it on screen. But basically all of those checking where the mouse is and telling the browser what the mouse should look like should happen in the event loop. And then we'll have a separate frame loop which is run once a frame, and I'm going to, at first anyway, I'm going to only run the frames every so often. So the Lemmings game has a timer in the corner that counts down, and roughly speaking, each lemming will make one action during 1 second that counts down. So they will lay one brick, they will bash forward one space, they will walk forward one space, they will climb up one space, and so on. And the game can be sped up or slowed down, at which point the clock speeds up and slows down. So what I'm going to do is the event loop is going to keep track of the time that's passed since the start of the last frame, and if 1 second has passed, or however long it takes given the current game speed, then it runs the frame loop again. And I'm hoping that my coding isn't bad enough that it takes more than 1 second to run the frame loop. So, let's start off by two functions. No, let. So what is my typing doing? Well, I know what my typing's doing. I've got very little space in front of me at the moment. This is probably going to cause us problems, but we can look at that if they come up. Do stuff, I guess. So we want to process inputs from the browser, send the browser contextual clue updates, and check if the frame loop should run. Don't want to export the game loop. Okay, so that's the easy bit. Now we need to make it work. Let's ignore browser inputs and contextual clues for now. I'm going to have to, you know what, I'm not going to deal with JavaScript dates. I haven't used much of DateFNS, but I know that I prefer it to JavaScript dates, which are just mind-bogglingly bad. So it's saying that I should just use the JavaScript 8. Ah, get you next time. So now it says it returns a number, but we need to rely on strongly typed, and that means that we need to know what kind of number. Given that in the year 2034 32-bit integer is no longer going to be enough, then I suggest we use a 64-bit unsigned. We don't want to use unsigned because Unix time can be negative, so let's do 64-bit signed. Why doesn't it like new date? JavaScript can do new date. I've done it plenty. Let's see. What is a flow file? I have no idea. Trying to find the file it's actually defined in. So benchmarks. Here we go. It definitely needs one option. Oh, now this is interesting. Assemblyscript has its own date. Oh, and Assemblyscript date.now returns an i64. Okay. In that case, we might need that later, but I'm not keeping it around. So this is going to be date.now. So, we need to track certain amounts of game state. So, let's do that here. So we should run into there. We can move. Yeah, it is I-64. Make that more explicit. And what else? There was something. Ah, game speed. So, as I remember, I think game speed goes from 1 to 100. So, I can do that all in an unsigned 8-bit integer. So, I think 50 is things happening 1 times a second. 100, I guess, would be. Let's look this up actually. Oh, that's a level description, isn't it? Yeah. I don't necessarily want that. Manual. Now this is going to be extremely helpful. Let's download a copy of that as well. On slower machines, time recorded by this isn't going to be real time. So level select objectives, view screen. map, pull down menus. Does that not speed up the game entirely? That will make things a lot simpler. Ah, fast forward. So, let's just very quickly check. So we've got increase flow rate, decrease flow rate, actions. I don't see fast forward on that screen. Fast forward, it says, should be between pause and Armageddon. See if there's any pictures of a game screen in here. Because I'm guessing this is for a different version. No. Okay then. That's interesting. I think I will code for that one because it's going to be a lot easier. That's just two speeds. Yeah, I don't think it says speed it up, it doesn't say by how much. Okay, that's Lemmings 2. Telling me how fast it goes. So let's just say we'll do it. Let's do that for now. And then not Boolean. This one is unsigned 8. Maximum, I think, is always 100. So I think 50 will spawn one every second. Now that's interesting. Might leave those mechanics and then kind of tweak them as we play along. Sometimes it's very good to just get something working fast and then just kind of play around with the numbers until you hit like the magic one that really works. It doesn't necessarily need to be extremely accurate to how you calculate it ahead of time. It's just what feels right sometimes. No comma. Minimum release rate 50. Release rate 50. Should run true. Let's define some constants here. One game loop per second and start off with 2. I suspect it's closer to 5 or 10, but we shall see about that. So toggle and here. We'll keep track of that in game state as well, but should probably put it near fast forward. Go at the top. here we so if that's an end game that should be here. So if they hit fast forward, then the fast forward boolean flips its state, and then we set base game loops per second down to the base, and if it's fast forwarding, we multiply it by the multiplier. So what this basically means is if fast forward is turned on, this will basically have no effect, and then this will make it faster. If it's already fast forwarding and it's turned off, this will reset the speed, and this won't execute. Alright. So that's in milliseconds, so I want to divide that by 1000. Event loop. So first thing that should happen is that, so not game loops per second, is it? Yeah. Ooh. I've got my units slightly muddled. I want milliseconds per game loop. Base milliseconds per game loop should be 1000. Fast forward multiplier can still stay as a multiplier. So, but then we want to divide it by the multiplier, which I shouldn't really be doing because division is expensive. But I can work out the binary math if that actually gets problematic. I don't do much with shifting, usually. So, and that means that we don't actually want to store that in seconds, we want to store it in milliseconds. Same with down here, so now this figure is milliseconds, and the math works out. remember to do that, otherwise it will just, after the first 1,000 milliseconds, it will just loop continuously. Okay. So I guess not that. Now the trouble is, because JavaScript is single-threaded, and I suspect AssemblyScript is single-threaded, while the game loop is processing, no events will process. Let's have a look. Multi-threaded WebAssembly. Interesting. Oh, I love this joke. Programmer has a problem. He thought to himself, I know, I'll solve it with threads. Has now problems too, he. Race conditions. Web workers. Threads is a stage 2 proposal. Well, I guess at some point we might be able to do that. I'm not going to dig into threads just yet. I suspect I'll have to do a lot of reading up in my own time and get a better idea and then bring it on stream. But looks like it's either possible or will soon be possible. Okay, so what's next? I want to take the contents of this. I suspect I'll have to update the JavaScript. So let's put those right at the top. And then here, we'll create a render function. just going to have to move everything into the loop, aren't I? Maybe not. Maybe what I want to do is... have a level object. Export. So the level will have a I honestly don't know how many the maximum is, but let's just say we probably won't be going above 255. I like my U8s, they don't waste much. Like, very rarely in programming do I ever need 16,000 of something in a counter. It's only with dates and times, really. But, like JavaScript, everything is just number. And you don't get to tell it this is an int or this is a float or whatever. Of course, here, a U8 is literally just a number. They just declared a type. But at least I can feel better knowing that I used it like that. Okay, so number of lemmings. How many you need to save to pass level, and the map. And then in this interface, we'll hard code a level. So the number of lemmings, I believe, is 10. Just off the top of my head. I think you only need one for success. Alright. Forgot the comma again. Our map, but what we're going to do is add a couple more. In fact, we just need one more, I think. So say there. So that looks like a little bit like that, except maybe we'll add in a layer of ground underneath. And I guess we could make it like even more. So let's just do ground space, space, space. background all up here. And I guess this ground all along here, but you can't really get to it. Well, there's sort of air all around there, isn't there? So let's do some more roof. Then we've got ground all along there. Bottom of the level. Yeah, that kind of looks like it. But I need a second air with the opening. There. So, fall there, onto there, go back and forth on here, or dig down and go to the exit. I guess maybe the exit spot there. Okay, I like that. That's our very fast Lemmings level. So in our game loop, we need, should run, but we also need level state. And in here, so it should be title screen, level select, level running, and end slate. So pull that in and we'll start it off on the title screen. We won't put any code in for that just yet, but if game state dot level state level running, so if it's running, that's long string, isn't it? Okay. Let's break that down a bit. Still more than 100 characters in that line, but I don't really want to break it out more than that. And already I'm doing math that I don't necessarily need to do. So if this level's running and the game loop's overdue, then we call the game loop. And the reason I wanted to do that is a load level. Really need to get better at types. And I need to set up TypeScript properly so it yells at me. In fact, am I even linting? Probably not, no. And in game state, I want to have the current level. Which isn't anything until we load it. And load level. Just passes in a level and we set the game state level. Level state. There it is. Level running. Which means from our main screen we can do the word level looks really weird to me now. Lowercase. So that loads, and then in our vendor section, we clear it. Level. So I believe, if I'm right, what we've just managed to do is exactly what we had before, but in way more code. And it will probably be happening once a second instead of just being static. So let's do without building it, let's just refresh. And that's just clearing once. And now if we build it again, it doesn't like it. Right. In that case, I am just going to take a quick break and I will be right back again to debug all of that. Okay, back to it. So let's get rid of this quickly, and that can go away. Right. That is all utterly useless. It doesn't tell me where in my code it failed. Like, if I'm using something I shouldn't be using, it should probably just tell me that. So let's just run untouched and see what that does. I can't even see what it's asserting from the code because it's minified. So, back to Google. Let's see what else they work on. Protobuf, yeah. Thought I recognized them. I contributed to Protobuf. See, people were getting this error back in 2019. The message still hasn't been updated. Finalize virtual stub. Compile. Measure. Main. build with dash s assertions equals 1 for more information. Well, that helps. Unless that's part of the script I can't control. Version help to config target. Source map debug. Debug information in the emitted binaries. I think we're doing debug anyway. No, that's target debug. So let's stick debug in there. It might help us out. Pedantic seems like the opposite of what we need right now. Libpath list files. Okay. So if debug doesn't help us, we can't do anything. Nope, it's still just the exact same thing. And we can't pass that through to the actual builder. Binary N. Right, let's just keep going through these issues then. All the assert messages are not helpful. No, they're not helpful. That's why it should kind of be updated. Okay, divide and conquer, they say. So, let's get rid of this. Let's get rid of basically all of this. And in, I know this bit works, so we can keep that. Well, let's not keep it exactly, let's move it, excuse me, up into load level. This, but not level state. These defines I need. Of course, I forgot to move them, so maybe that was causing it. That can go. Right, hopefully that's as minimal as it needs to get. Don't need that. Still doesn't like it. No. Save that. Okay. How about get rid of some of the types? Right, so this is literally just doing exactly what I had before, I expect. Okay, something better. Find name any. So let's just get rid of that type. Type expected. Okay, so let's grab this, put it in the index. in the index as well. If this doesn't work, then I will have to go and look at what their objects can actually be. And back to the assertions. Please read the docs. Like, okay, but reading the documentation, like, everyone makes coding mistakes. Even if you know the documentation back and forward, you're going to make coding mistakes. Having documentation is no excuse for having really bad error messages. I know Assemblyscript is sort of a new, like, what's the actual age of it? It's really hard to tell. Like, it's got over 1,000 commits. It's going to be really difficult to find the oldest one. Maybe. But anyway, that issue is back in 2019, so yeah, it really should be better by now. Nothing. Okay, so type rules, casting, inference, nullability, assignability, bit shift, macro types. Debugging, source maps, doesn't help with the compiler. Nope, there's just very little documentation here. samples. Can I even use objects at all? That looks like it's an interface. So can I have classes but not interfaces? Let's have a look at exactly what I can do here. Right. So these are all declaring types, declaring consts, functions. That's a variable, not a const. That's interesting. Space, so you can have enums. I've seen enums, I've seen classes, namespaces. It looks like interfaces are all defined in namespaces. No, here's an interface. There's an interface. So obviously interfaces are okay, but let's just let's just turn this into a class. See if it likes that any better. Okay, let's try that. Well, we got a little bit farther. We need these and comment this out. Huh. So, did it just not like the interfaces? If it doesn't, then I guess we just use classes. And just check that this does something right. Okay. So, let's check that works. Seems to. That to get rid of this. And in loop, want those back and want to import level. Still builds and still runs. Okay. So now let's get rid of these and uncomment the whole lot. Did I actually need those declares? Yes, I did. So, I want to load the level. So no more interfaces. I thought we had a few more, but that's fine. So what I definitely want to do is in my JavaScript. After 10 seconds, to tell it to stop the game. And in my index file, not that one. After I load the level, in fact, before I want event loop. Now this is interesting. If I, that's a while. So is this just going to spin round indefinitely and it never gets to this load level? Guess we'll see. Oh, it doesn't like that. Does it think that's a U8? Because I told it. What I didn't do. Yeah, those were U8s, but can I just do that for a cast? So it doesn't like that. Okay, so I will need to could make the assumption that it's never going to be more than 256. We're dealing thousands, so if it's milliseconds per, then I don't want it to be U8, do I? Because that's 1,000, and 1,000 is way out of U8, so U16 should be suitable. But then we still have the casting issue. So U16 Let's grab this. So let's just assume that if we're checking if the delta's been more than U16 or the delta is more than the game loop. Millisecond timer. Which should be fine because we're not ever going to set this more than 1,000, probably. What else? It's not doing the type gating properly. So it might complain about that line I just added in, but if so, we can add an explicit cast. Right, hopefully most of those errors have gone now. That needs to be U16 as well. And looks like we're done. So what I'm expecting to see here is it to render the map I was just wondering, why is that there? Probably because I haven't refreshed it since I got there. Since I updated the map. Okay, so I'm expecting down here to clearing to display 10 times and then stop updating. Which it's not doing. And it's still the old map. Because I got rid of my test function, and that's what index.js is calling, isn't it? Yes. See if that does anything. Type expected, it says. It should say return type expected. Nope, still loading the old stuff. Right, I think... Is it building into the wrong folder again? Let's delete both my builds and see where it's going. Oh, it's going into both. Yeah, I know why that is. It's because I these from index to loop. So nothing happened. The reason nothing happened is probably what I was saying before. The event loop was happening before I loaded the level, and single threaded, it just goes round and round and round in a circle. I'm hoping that's what it is anyway. But if it is, then I need an interrupt system which I might have to run the main loop in JavaScript so that everything else gets time to process. Yeah, this is locked up. This has also locked up. Let's get the dev tools. Yeah, so now I need to learn how to make a game loop in WebAssembly, but I think I will call it a night there. Thank you for watching, for anyone who popped by. I didn't see any chat messages. I'm hoping that's not because Twitch just decided not to show me anything. I will be streaming again tomorrow at 2 PM UK time. Which is about 15 and a half hours from now, I think. And if you want to see the continued development of what is currently a white screen, give me a follow and come along for the journey. Right, bye.